Welcome back, astronomers. We've all looked up at the night sky and seen the countless stars that make up our universe. But have you ever wondered how all of those stars came to be and what will happen to them in the future? Today, we will be learning all about how brand new stars form and the life cycle of stars in our universe. By the end of this lesson, you will be able to identify each stage in the life cycle of an average-sized star and explain the process of nuclear fusion and its role in star formation. Let's begin with the birth of new stars. New stars are formed in giant clouds of dust and gases, like hydrogen and helium in space. These giant clouds are called nebula. The dust and gases within a nebula are very spread out, but gravity slowly begins to pull clumps together. As the clumps get bigger and bigger, their gravitational pull becomes stronger and stronger. Eventually, the large clump of gas and dust will get so big that it collapses from its own gravity. This collapse pulls lots of heavy, dense material to the center, forming what is called a protostar. A protostar is defined as a very young star that is still gathering mass. The protostar's gravitational pull will continue pulling material from the nebula into it. Once it gathers enough material, the core of the protostar becomes hot enough to begin the process that powers the star, nuclear fusion. Nuclear fusion is the process that makes our sun shine and powers all the stars in the universe. Fusion is when two or more lighter atoms, the smallest unit of matter, come together to make a heavier one. Within stars, including our sun, two hydrogen atoms fuse together to form one helium atom. When this happens, a very tiny bit of matter releases an immense amount of energy in the form of heat and light. This is why stars shine so brightly and why nuclear fusion is such a powerful source of energy. Once the star begins the process of nuclear fusion, it is known as a main sequence star. This is where stars spend the vast majority of their lifetime. You can think of nuclear fusion like a star's fuel, and as a main sequence star, it progressively burns through this fuel. Once it runs out of hydrogen atoms to fuse into helium, it will use up all its fuel and burn out. Luckily for us, this process takes a long time. Our sun is a main sequence star, and it still has billions of years before it burns out. Once a star is considered to be a main sequence star, the events of its life are determined by one thing, its size. Astronomers have determined that the stages stars go through depend on whether the star is an average-sized star or a massive star. Our sun, for example, is an average-sized star. Now that you've learned about nuclear fusion and how it is the energy source for stars, it's time to think like an astronomer. Why do you think the life cycle of stars is different for average-sized stars and massive stars? Pause the video and record your answer in the guided notes. If you mentioned that massive stars are much bigger than average-sized stars and therefore have much more fuel, you were absolutely correct. This leads to different stages throughout the life cycle of massive stars. But we'll continue down the path of average-sized stars for now. Although it takes billions of years, these stars will eventually fuse most of their hydrogen and run out of fuel. When this occurs, the star will expand and cool down, becoming a red giant star. In the red giant phase, the star will begin to fuse its helium into heavier elements like carbon and oxygen in its core. Then the outer layers cool off and expand until they are up to 1,000 times larger than the original star was. Once the helium in the core of the red giant star is used up, The star expels the outer layers of gas in an explosion of gases and dust known as a planetary nebula. These nebulas aren't really related to planets, though. When astronomers discovered them hundreds of years ago, their telescopes were much weaker than ours are today, so they thought these clouds looked like planets. Since red giant stars use up all their fuel and expel their outer layers when they form a planetary nebula, what's left is only a tiny core of heavy elements. This is called a white dwarf star. The entire mass of the star's core is condensed down to as little as 1% of its original size, so you can imagine how massively dense it is. Eventually, this core cools down and evaporates into gas that drifts off into space. And meanwhile, the planetary nebula that exploded out from it drifts off into space too. Eventually, these gases may scatter into a stellar nebula, and the process starts all over again. Astronomers have discovered stars in our universe from all different stages. This has allowed us to get a better understanding of the fascinating process stars undergo and has allowed us a wonderful glimpse into our universe and our place within it. Thank you for joining me on our expedition through the life cycle of stars. In the next lesson, we will discover the stages that massive stars go through and how they differ from average-sized stars. Let's recap what we learned today. You now know that stars begin as bits of gas and dust in a stellar nebula that come together to form a protostar. A protostar eventually gathers enough material and heat for nuclear fusion to occur, causing it to become a main sequence star. When that main sequence star uses up all its fuel, it cools down and expands to become a red giant. And lastly, a red giant expels its outer layers to create a planetary nebula, leaving a white dwarf star behind, and the cycle starts over again. Be sure to complete the practice questions and extension activities that go with this lesson as you continue your journey into the universe. And always remember, you are out of this world. Hey, hey.